and every one of you. I'm going to have our welcome done. My deaconess Hedy, if she would please give us our welcome this morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
To our visitors, you're at the right place at the right time. You're here for a special day today, but I want you to know that you're welcome to come worship with us any day.
Amen.
That our church doors are open.
That's right.
Our doors swing on welcome hinges, and that means that anytime our doors are open, you're welcome to come on in.
Amen.
And you know, it is a special day, and look like I just don't have adequate words to tell you how welcome you are to be with us today. But just make yourself at home, and we love and praise the Lord, and I know you're going to hear a word from God.
Amen. Amen.
Not just today,
yes,
but anytime we are in the house that the word of God is coming forth.
Amen.
So just feel welcome to come back and be with us again. They have been baptized,
yes,
but we have service every Sunday. Except the fifth Sunday and the first Sunday in October. All other Sundays, you're welcome, welcome, welcome.
Amen.
From the bar stand to the door.
Amen.
From the ceiling to the floor.
Tell us.
You are welcome, welcome, welcome.
Amen. Come in and smell that good food cooking. Amen. Amen. Y'all know how it is. And this time we're going to have our choir, if they would please, they're going to sing another selection for us. And following that, we're going to have what thus said the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
With the saints, to be in the midst of his people and to enjoy the goodness of the Lord as he provides. Amen. I thank God for all of you friends and family, visitors, and those of you who have come to hear a word from the Lord. I thank God for you. Amen. Amen. I thank God for our deacon, deaconess, auxiliary leaders. Thank God for the ushers and where they are. Amen. Thank God for everybody in the building. Amen. Amen. We come to glorify his name. And if you have any God in you, you need to be able to praise him too. Amen. You don't need nobody to pump you up. Hallelujah. If you woke up with the Spirit this morning, if you woke up with Jesus on your mind this morning, you came with a praise in your heart. Amen. Glory to God. All my associates, I thank God for them. Amen. I will be on vacation next week. I won't be able to be back to preach, I guess, until November, actually, because I'll be gone next week, and then the following week will be the union, and then I'll be back in November. Amen. Amen. But you'll be in my prayers in my heart, and they have my contact information, and I'll still be doing what God called me to do. Amen. Amen. Let us take our attention to the book of Luke. And as we're turning, I thank the Lord for my wife who's here with me today.
Amen.
We're on the road quite a bit. We got in late last night, and here we are back up and ready to go again.
Amen.
We thank God for the traveling mercies and safety he has afforded us. But I will say this, if you ever hear tell a brother not making it home, don't worry about me because I just went on home. I'm good. I always tell people, you can't live if you're afraid to die.
That's right.
Yeah, you can't do nothing if you're afraid to die. Anything you do for God is always a risk involved. Amen. He that spared not his own son. Hallelujah. So we need to understand that every time we're doing something for the Lord, we need to stop trying to save our own life. We need to just go on and do it. Amen. Amen. So if you turn with me to the book of Luke, the 15th chapter. Yeah, don't worry about bro.
All right.
I'll just say, well, he died doing what God called him to do. Don't worry about bro. 15th chapter, I'll read the fourth verse. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep.
Amen.
Father, we're so grateful and thankful for your love this morning. Thankful for your gratefulness and your goodness. We ask, Lord God, that you bless the house. Bless the hearts that have come. We ask, Lord God, that I decrease, that you increase. Preach the word, Spirit of God, that we might sit at your feet and learn from you. And we'll be forever grateful In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. This morning, I'd like to introduce this topic this morning. You can't have fellowship if you don't have fellowship. You can't have fellowship if you don't have fellowship. And primarily, I'll be speaking to our new members that have come with us today. I've listened to many ministries that preach the Word of God, and it seems that they have stretched things a bit too far and have afforded us things that the Scriptures don't allow. Primarily, I'm thinking of in most ministries, they teach a type of individualism. I got mine, and you need to get yours. I'm going to heaven anyway. But the Scripture really does not afford us that kind of definition when it comes to being a part of the body of Christ. You see, there are no going along parts in the body of Christ. There are no parts in the body of Christ that says, well, God has gifted me and I'm going to use my talents at the Apollo. The gifts in the body are designed for the body, and the people that are in the body must stay in the body.
All right.
We find that the world now has afforded us a definition that says that we can go to heaven and we ain't got to belong to nothing. We can go and believe in Jesus in our own little corner somewhere. We can believe in him and how we want to believe in him. And we can come to the house of God whenever we want to. But here in this parable, Jesus seems to be signaling something that's quite different than what we've been taught. He says that suppose you had some sheep, 100, and one of them went astray.
All right.
Would you not go and find the one and bring him on back?
Yeah.
I'm finding that Jesus, first of all, is telling this parable to those that felt like that he should have not been accepting others into the body. They felt like that he was sitting with sinners and he shouldn't have been doing that, and therefore Jesus told them this parable. Well, Matthew tells the parable in a different angle. He tells the parable of being in the body and those in church mistreating you. Don't you know there's some mean folk in the church? New members that are coming in. There are some mean folk in the church. There are some people here that shouldn't be in a church nowhere, but there are some mean folk in the church. But he tells this parable of the lost sheep that had went away and gone astray. Now there's one thing about this parable that I like us to focus on, and that is the sheep. The one that went astray. Now, the sheep that went astray did not know that he was lost. The sheep didn't know that he was lost. The sheep was just out doing his own thing. Come on, Spirit. The sheep that went astray and was gone didn't know that he was lost. And obviously, the other sheep that was left behind didn't care that the other sheep was gone. You know how some of us are. Some of us glad when sister or brother so-and-so don't come to church because they're always raising so much hell. We don't care if they stay at home. But Jesus is trying to tell us that that's not what it means to be in fellowship with the rest of the sheep. You got to accept the good and the bad. You got to accept the ugly and the in the body of Christ.
He
said that the man had 90, he had 100 sheep. And he thought a lot about that one sheep. You know, if you had $1 million and you lost a dollar, what'd you go find? Oh, you laughing, ain't you? Oh, you laughing, ain't you? If you got 1,000 members in your church and one get missing, will you go and look for the one? Some of us believe because we have so much that we can afford to lose a little bit. But what Jesus is trying to tell us, you can't afford to lose anything, and you got to change the way you think in order to keep the body together. Can you afford to lose your nose? No. Can you afford to lose your eyes? No. But we got to learn that when it comes to those that are in the body, we got to care about them. We got to know what's going on with them so that we can look for them if they just so happen. Don't make it a couple Sundays to church. So a sheep was out there all by itself, not knowing that it was lost. The second thing that the sheep didn't know is that it was in danger. See, we got to realize that when you're not in fellowship, you are in danger. Sheep does not have natural defenses. The only thing they can do is gather together, make themselves look bigger through numbers, and that way they can intimidate the enemy. But when you're out there all by yourself and you're doing your own thing, not knowing that you're lost, not knowing that you're in danger, the enemy has a way of getting you away from the path. So here's the sheep, out there lost, out of fellowship with the body and out of fellowship with his master. I'm going to bring this home now for you guys. Let us think for a moment how we were before we got saved. We all probably was raised up in the church. Our moms and dads probably drug us all the way to church, and we come up through the church. But then something happened, and we got out there in the club, and boy, the preacher's daughter and son, they danced the best I've ever seen. They drink the most, they can cut off the most, but something happened to us that we were out there in the street. And when I thought about what God was saying and how he brought it to me, I thought about something that all of us didn't think about when we were out there. None of us thought that we were lost. I said none of us thought that we were lost. We were out there doing our own thing. We were celebrating with the crowd. We were drinking as much as the next one had drunk. We were following the ways of the devil, but it never crossed our mind that we were lost.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. traditions of what it means to be Christian. But God does not afford us to make our own definition of what it means to be Christ-like. We got the definitions of Scripture that teach us we need to be in fellowship. If we're claiming to have some fellowship, we need to be with the Lord's people and gather in His name and serve Him, not the devil. And He says, and when I find, look at your neighbor and say, when he found. You thought you were happy when he found. But the Bible says, God is the best dancer there is. The word said he cut a ring. The word said he called all the angels of heaven. He called his neighbor. He called everybody. He said, I want to show y'all this new dance I got.
Turn it over.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
So the motion has been carried and fulfilled today. So now I transition them from candidate to members here at Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church. Amen. 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 Amen.